Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seat. We are going to start now with the second day of the Eurodig. Good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to welcome Marina Kaljurand, the Understate Secretary, Undersecretary Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Estonia. Unfortunately, the minister could not come due to urgent issues in the country, so we are very happy to have Marina here participating today, and it's my great pleasure to let you know that she will not only give us a keynote speech, but she will also actively participate in the workshop on cybersecurity, workshop 5, which is very much appreciated that we get such a great expertise into the equal-footed and overall Eurodig discussion. Marina, the floor is yours.
Good morning, everybody. Sandra, thank you so much for a kind introduction, and I'm really sorry that our foreign minister couldn't join us today, but I'm privileged and honored to deliver speech on behalf of her. And I wish that more people could join us. I understand that yesterday you had a great evening. I'm sorry I missed that. I'm very pleased to address the Eurodig 8th annual meeting today here in Sofia. It was fascinating to read how it all started. A couple of friends meeting in a brasserie in Paris, drinking wine and using the paper tablecloth to visualize the concept of European dialogue on internet-related matters. It reminded me of another story. A few youngsters in the late 90s, in an apartment in Tallinn, developing a file transfer program called Kazaa. These were those guys who later used the same idea of peer-to-peer technology for creating internet phone calls, an invention that billions of people today use as Skype. Even if the dimensions are different, and I bet that the block of flats in Tallinn was somewhat less elegant than the brasserie in the French capital, there is something similar about big things. Unfaltering commitment, constant innovation, hard work, and above all, passion. This has made Eurodig a forum that has impact, a forum with a growing number of participants and blended mix of stakeholders. I'm also very happy that the event is taking place in Sofia, in the beautiful capital of Bulgaria. I know it's maybe not very trendy to start with rumors, but I do not know how much truth there is in the rumor that Facebook founder Mark Zuckerberg had a Bulgarian grandfather, or that Bulgarian roots were what inspired John Atanasoff to design the first electronic digital computing device at the University of Iowa in the late 30s of the last century. But what I know for sure is that our hosts have always been inspiring with their spontaneous creativity and innovation. Thank you very much for all your work in contributing to the program, and of course also for your warm hospitality. I would like to make a few points on what is important to Estonia when it comes to the internet. Human rights, cybersecurity, the internet as an engine for economic growth for Europe and beyond, and internet governance as the connectivity framework. I will start with freedom of expression on the internet. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Much better now, thanks. I will start with freedom of expression on the internet. Perhaps I'm stating obvious in this forum, but safeguarding freedom of expression and opinion on the internet is an inseparable part of fundamental rights, dignity, and the worth of humans. It forms an essential part of the 21st century human rights, Freedom of opinion and expression is as much a fundamental right on its own accord as it is an enabler of other rights, such as economic, social, and cultural rights. Adopted by consensus, the United Nations Human Rights Council Resolution on Human Rights on the Internet recognizes that freedom of expression, which is valid offline, should also be valid online. It should therefore be simple, yet everybody in this room knows that it's not. Governments violate both freedom of expression offline and online, on the European continent as on all the other continents. In the context of technical development and increasing internet penetration, we see that the vibrant and rapidly growing online community is often a leeway for alternative voices and popular political dissent, particularly in authoritarian countries where traditional media outlets continue to fall under strict government control. The Freedom House report, Freedom on the Net 2014, shows that freedom of expression on the internet is deteriorating, and in fact, has been doing so for the third year in a row. In too many countries, citizens face intimidation, threats, arrests, and the fines from the state because of their activities online. Even in Western democracies, there are worrisome legal developments that seek to grant the government broader power to restrict online contact. What could be done? What should be done? What should we do? We share the view that we do not need new documents. We need the implementation of the already existing commitments. There are a number of international instruments that are at our disposal. At the UN level, we have to use the UPR process to reiterate the condemnation of restrictions on freedom of expression and call the countries in question to fully respect international human rights law. Estonia has done so in a number of UPR cycles already, and we are encouraging other governments to do the same. The Council of Europe has recently launched a couple of interesting initiatives. For example, a platform for the safety of journalists and freedom of expression, which is an alert mechanism where organizations of media actors can post information regarding violations. I would also like to praise the work of the OSCE representative on freedom of media, Dunja Mijatović, whose engagement is particularly important in dialogue with different governments of OSCE member states. Estonia is very strongly engaged in the Freedom Online Coalition, a group of 26 countries who have committed to working together to support internet freedom and protect freedom of expression and fundamental human rights more generally, in close cooperation with all the stakeholders, governments, civil society, and the private sector. The coalition is supporting the digital human rights activists on the ground through funding and through moral support, which is often as vital as financial. Estonia chaired the coalition in 2014, and we are proud of the Tallinn agenda that was adopted last year at the high-level conference in Tallinn. From here, I would like to continue with the limitations to freedom of expression. Indeed, freedom of expression is not absolute. Article 19 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights provides that exercising the freedom may sometimes be subject to restrictions. These restrictions have to be exceptional, prescribed by law, be precise and clear. Last but not least, these restrictions should pursue a legitimate aim and allow for effective remedies. One example of where restrictions may be necessary is hate speech. We have witnessed recently a wave of hate speech against women on the internet, which is accompanied by threats including murders and sexual assault. This form of hate speech targets female politicians, journalists, human rights activists, but also ordinary women who dare to express their opinion or campaign for equal rights. I share the view that if we do not combat this particular form of discrimination, we will never be able to eliminate violence against women, which is one of the most extreme forms of violation of women's rights. And I stress again, also in this context, the restrictions should be imposed based on a strict and predictable legal framework with due judicial oversight and be proportionate to the aim. On the European continent, it is the European Court of Human Rights which has been tasked to find the right balance between freedoms and restrictions. It is therefore in everybody's interest that the court has enough resources, is efficient, and of course independent. Member states should implement judgments and contribute to the raising of public awareness of court case law. In straight legal terms, judgments are binding only in regards to the state, not only in regards to the state in question. However, they surely have wider policy implications. I would also like to touch upon internet trolling as another fairly new phenomenon. I read a story in the New York Times last Wednesday this week of how the government of one country has developed a complex myriad of trolls who get paid based on a fixed rate per comment or post for spreading state propaganda, sometimes hate speech, and also war propaganda. Of course, we cannot close our eyes in regards to such a practice. At the same time, we cannot respond by closing or restricting open spaces, since the same measures may have adverse effects and worsening the conditions of freedom of expression further. I think our answer to this should be more freedom of expression and not less, accompanied by raising awareness of the threats. When talking about freedom of expression, one should also focus on the protection of privacy. Privacy and freedom online must continuously be advanced, equally and together. There are complementary values and fundamental for the realization of other human rights and the basis of democratic societies. We all are aware that while opening up new possibilities for global citizens, the internet can also strengthen the hands of governments in some areas where many of us would not like to see them intervening. This is not true only with respect to savvy authoritarian states who squash protests and censor dissent, but also with respect to democratic countries where governments have built the capacity to gather massive quantities of information concerning their people. It is not assuring anymore that phone calls, emails, and social networking data are collected because they are relevant to crime investigations or essential in protecting citizens against international terrorism. The former UN Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Expression, Marc Laroux, among others, has in one of his reports warned that broad interpretation of outdated laws are enabling sophisticated and invasive surveillance measures to flourish around the world, and governments should draw new regulations that properly acknowledge their growing power. More pessimistic views have predicted that the world is galloping into a new form of totalitarianism, where the power of entire populations is transferred to an unaccountable complex of transnational spy agencies and corporations. The key word in this debate is democratic control. I agree that some surveillances may be needed in certain justified cases, but in a democratic country, it can be legitimate only if it is based on informed consent, not on blind trust in the government. The level of public scrutiny of the legal basis of any kind of surveillance has to be adequate. In simple words, it should be citizens or their elected representatives, not spies and secret courts, who ought to decide what is right and what is not. Unfortunately, there is some mistrust also between partners in Europe and beyond. Therefore, international cooperation is more needed than ever in ensuring that surveillance practices by state security, law enforcement agencies and private companies are in line with international human rights obligations and standards. There is a need to monitor, analyze and report about the situation in respect of the right to privacy. We therefore strongly support the creation of a mandate of the UN Special Rapporteur for the right to privacy. A new Special Rapporteur will bear a huge responsibility by creating the first image of a mandate and by being able to make recommendations to states on the implementation and realization of the right to privacy, including reporting on violations. We hope that the right person will be found to match this challenge. At the Council of Europe, Human Rights Commissioner Muzhniaks has expressed his interest to look into the democratic control of surveillance. Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe has made some reasonable recommendations what governments should do. We very much support this work. Now some remarks about cybersecurity. Given the important and increasing role that ICTs play in economic growth and social progress, as well as in the shared goal of protecting human rights and freedoms online, security constitutes an integral and necessary element in developing and sustaining modern information societies. Estonia can speak from our own experience about how an ICT-centric lifestyle and social progress can be threatened by motivated and international state and non-state actors. Modern states need to be vigilant, resilient, and prepared against the threat of cyber attacks. There are several reasons why we need to take cybersecurity seriously. First and foremost, ICTs are vulnerable. And our dependence on the societal and governmental functions of these advanced but inherently vulnerable technologies will only deepen at a national level and expand globally. Secondly, the cyber realm constitutes an operational domain. Many states have announced the development of military cyber capabilities. Many more states are de facto engaged in the development of such capabilities. Thirdly, we are facing serious challenges in the fight against cybercrime. Our failure to get cybercrime under effective control directly inhibits trust in, and therefore the development of, ICTs and the information society. We are seeing an alarming tendency of deepening links between cybercrime, transnational organized crime, and serious national security threats. The broad use of digital services demands a high level of digital security. McKinsey and the World Forum and the World Economic Forum published a joint paper last year estimating that the material effect of slowing the pace of technology and innovation due to a lack of cyber resiliency could be as high as $3 trillion annually by 2020. Cybercrime is also on the rise and already extracts between 15 to 20% of the value created by the internet. Data breaches have been causing substantial monetary loss for years. The number of lost or stolen data records increased by almost 80% in 2014 compared to 2013. These are worrying numbers and threats undermining the potential and value of digitalization. Besides the fact that many countries are developing and deploying offensive cyber capabilities through their security agencies, or through proxy organizations, there has been a fundamental shift to what is called advanced persistent threats, stealthy cyber attacks directed at business and political targets over a prolonged time. Such attacks' objectives typically extend beyond immediate financial gain. We are fundamentally concerned of APTs. Furthermore, criminal syndicates and hacktivists are using the territory and infrastructure of state to launch attacks for political purposes or illegal gain. Again, these are worrying trends that will affect regional and strategic stability and international relations. In this rather gloomy state of affairs, what can states and non-state actors do to preserve openness and improve security online? A comprehensive and systematic approach to cybersecurity has to start at a national level. It's not an easy task. The complexity of cybersecurity interdependencies is a growing challenge for all states to comprehend and manage. First of all, states must be willing to make dramatic changes to their perceptions and practices of internet security and governance if they are to prevent cyber attacks. Governments need to assume the role of both the protectors and the exploiters of technology. They are to protect their economic environment, critical infrastructure, as well as private and public users. As in many other cases involving cyberspace, public-private partnership is crucial for strengthening cybersecurity, starting from a basic cyber hygiene regime and extending to national infrastructure support of energy, financial, and healthcare systems. Like with other internet-related issues, the key is to invest in public awareness, training, and education, the latter covering a broad base of e-skills. This would empower citizens to grasp how their information, communication, and transactions are handled online. This would also help citizens and companies to understand what damage cyber attacks can cause and thus encourage taking action. The good news is that there seems to be a general understanding that when it comes to ICTs and cyberspace, we are dealing with an ecosystem in which everything is interconnected. It functions as a whole, and it must be defended as a whole. However, the biggest disagreement, both nationally and internationally, is not what the outcome ought to be, but how to get there. Building international and interdisciplinary cooperation is essential to have and maintain a free, open, and safe cyberspace. We already have several good forums for discussions and to develop our security measures. The EU has issued its first comprehensive policy document in this area. The OSCE has come up with measures to increase transparency, cooperation, and trust at the regional level. The continued expansion of the Council of Europe Convention of Cybercrime demonstrates the growing realization of governments that by developing and utilizing a consistent and proven legal framework, we can tackle cybercrime head and eventually eliminate criminal safe havens. Large-scale cyber exercises hosted by the NATO Cooperative Cyber Defense Center in Tallinn are an excellent example of how countries prepare together to overcome cyber threats. Estonia is also a member of the United Nations group of governmental experts that is currently working to find common normative ground on responsible state behavior in cyberspace. What are we learning from international cooperation is that we need to be more inclusive if we want to succeed. We need to listen to other regions. We need to approach developing countries, not only like-minded allies or the major cyber powers. We need to hear not only what the IT sector thinks, but what concerns many other sectors. And we need to reach out to academia to broaden our horizons. We, the governments, also have to start asking policy-relevant questions from our academia, civil society, and the private sector. We all have agreed that international law applies to cyberspace. Now we have to agree how. We think that we do not need new international treaties, but rather a consensus on how existing international law applies to cyberspace. This can and should be a gradual process where we examine the existing norms, both international law and politically binding norms, to find common ground on some basic questions that concern us all. This is an area where scholars and experts can make a substantive contribution to the dialogue going on at the government level. In the absence of commonly agreed upon standards of responsible state behavior, it is a task, not an opportunity, as well as a duty for policymakers, academics, and other experts to contribute to the ongoing discussion about norms and what is normal. We consider it essential that countries obey the norms and spirit of international law and do not take advantage of the still bending international consensus of norms of responsible state behavior or the existing legal lacuna. Yes, we agree that cyberspace has unique characteristics compared to other domains and kinetic activities, but such characteristics should not be viewed as impediments to the application of international law. Instead, they suggest the need for more detailed analysis of the preconditions for and implications of the implementation of relevant norms. We call on states to define and implement responsible behavior. This is required not only to maintain international peace and security, but also to secure the social and economic benefits that ICTs bring. For Estonia, the socio-economic and political military aspects of cybersecurity are tightly intertwined and equally important. I would also argue that the socialization of cybersecurity is the next big thing. It often seems that we're repeating the same slogans, but without necessarily understanding each other. We need policymakers, technologists, lawyers, activists, academics to start speaking the same language. What's more, we need for the average citizen in our countries to talk the talk as well. This is the language that starts with basic individual cyber hygiene and ends with universally respected rules of responsible state behavior in cyberspace. This is the language of progress and stability in the cyber age, walking the walk. Security is never absolute. At the end of the day, it's about tolerating and managing real risks. We should not forget what cybersecurity is for. The world has experienced incredible economic and social growth as a result of the development and use of ICTs. The internet and interconnectivity have become powerful tools for social progress and economic benefits. I heard that yesterday you had a very interesting opening panel on how to shape the European digital market. Keen adopter of the benefits of information society, we are firm supporters of this process. We also realize how much potential is still unused. In this context, we welcome the release of the European Commission's Digital Single Market Strategy, an ambitious plan on how to advance European digital single market that crosses the borders, but also ensures cybersecurity, the protection of personal data, and helps disruptive digital enterprises to fit into the regulatory model we have developed over 60 years. We all have to work together to make this plan a reality. Again, it will not be easy, but I'm confident that Europe will continue to follow an open, liberal model that is based on the rule of law. I am also sure that we will be able to develop the regulation which is necessary to protect the interests of different stakeholders. The debate about the European digital single market is closely connected with another major theme very important for Estonia, the preservation of the multi-stakeholder internet governance model. Internet governance should be seen as the platform from any issues that I have already touched upon today: freedom of expression, right to privacy, cybersecurity, and economic growth. There have been many discussions what does the multi-stakeholder model mean in different fora, also during the last days here in Sofia. In Estonian language, by the way, we need 6 words to describe what we mean, and even then, I'm not sure whether all understand what we're talking about. But I think the essence of it is actually not so complicated. This has been very well captured by the German Foreign Minister Frank-Walter Steinmeier in his opening speech of the last year's Eurodig in Berlin. He said, I quote, "It takes many to run the internet, and it takes many to make sure it remains free, safe, and open." We believe that Europe should be one of the main actors defending open, free, and bottom-up internet in the major global internet governance process this year, be it VCs plus 10, with the extension of the mandate of IGF, ENA, transition, or ICANN accountability. Furthermore, we should not forget that 2015 is European Year of Development, and the year when the Sustainable Development Goals will be agreed. We have to provide development assistance to less developed countries in order to connect the unconnected billion and address different issues from cybersecurity threats to employing information and communication technologies for growth, public health, and education. International organizations and the states should review their development cooperation and technical assistance programs and direct them more towards information society-related capacity building projects. Our experience is that this will be money well spent. We also need a better coordination of efforts between donors and bringing the development cooperation and cyber community, the public and private sector. Estonia has initiated cooperation with countries who would like to build a well-functioning e-governance system. We have been approached by many developing countries who have made setting up an e-government their national objective. The first cooperation projects have already been implemented in Moldova, Georgia, Ukraine, and with the Palestinian National Authority. And work is continuing with the governments of many other countries, including the region of Southeast Europe. Our proactive approach means that we have also opened up our e-government applications to the world through our e-residency program and making many central solutions open source. We want the entire world to benefit fully from the digital revolution, and we are ready to work with any and all countries who share our goal and dream of a free, open, and secure internet for all. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to end my speech by thanking everybody for being part of the Eurodig. It is the participation of each one of you that makes this conference so special and a great venue to speak. I will later be discussing some more details in the panel on cybersecurity and hope to see at least some of you there. And I would like to wish us all a good continuation of the conference. Thank you.
Thank you Marina, this was a very great speech, and I think it would be in the sense of the juridic community if we could open this text on the juridic wiki, so for those who were not able or who like to read again it, so would that be possible then? Wonderful. Now we are going to start with the next panel. It's Frederick Donk who is doing the moderation. How can the open internet coexist with new IP services? It's basically about net neutrality. There was already a session, an early morning session today, discussing the outcome paper, which is, well, in a sort of an experiment, how to produce meaningful outcome within the juridic, which can be later submitted to a global fora. This panel, we're not necessarily talking about this document. It will be a net neutrality panel. But Frederick will explain at the end of this panel more regarding this document and how we are going to proceed with it. So Frederick, the floor is yours. Please invite your panelists.
Thank you very much. And indeed, I would like to invite, if they are in the room, the panelists for the juridic, for the network neutrality session. I have Eva Ponova, Amelia Anderzotter, Luca Belli, and Gonzalo Lopez. And Fred Sorensen, of course. Sorry, Fred. So please, have a seat. Thank you. So, yes, it will be about network neutrality. You know, this is still a very sensitive topic. It's just a bit less sensitive, if I may say, than 10 years ago. At least we have people who agree, like today, to sit around the same table and discuss the topic. So it's already a great improvement. Everybody knows that this is still under discussion at the European Union level. We're in the middle of a trialogue. We should see something soon. Maybe not white smoke from the Latvian presidency. I don't know. I'm not in the secret. But yet, there are a lot of discussion going on. This is something I'd like to come back on, actually. This is the paper that we produced in the working group ahead of this juridic meeting. Is that okay? Well, is that better like this? Okay, cool. Network neutrality, we all agree, is a very difficult concept. It's an ill-defined concept we used to say for years, and actually it's true. Whenever I go in a room or we stand discussing network neutrality, you understand people actually have different things in mind. Freedom of speech, competition issues, non-discrimination, traffic management, bandwidth management, etc. So what we've done in the working group ahead of this meeting, and that might just become a draft statement for the Euroleague, was to address different angles. And actually we thought it would be a good idea not to try to tackle network neutrality as such, but try to take different angles. We will do the same here, hence the title of this session, which is How Can the Global Internet Coexist with IP services or specialized services, whatever you call them. I anticipate that we will address much more than this, but this is the angle we wanted to take. To help me doing this today, I have a wonderful panel, really multi-stakeholder, experts in their field, starting with you, Eva Ponova. You are a member of the European Parliament from the EPP group. You also are one of the founders of the Digital Agenda Intergroup. You're part of IMCO, among others, meaning Internet Market and Consumer Protection. You're Bulgarian from Sofia. You're one of the youngest MEPs, so we're very happy to have you here. Thank you. Amelia Andersdotter, for most people, you're still an MEP. You were an MEP not far away. You are now having many hats like most of us. You are a student, you are a member of FITUC. Thanks for joining. Frode Sorensen, you are with the Norwegian Communications Authority, but for many people, including myself, you're also one of the leader experts within the BEREC, which is the group of the European regulators on network neutrality issues. Thanks for being with us. Luca Belli, you also have many hats. I guess that I might say that your DNA is being an academic, although you've done many other stuff. You are one of the founders or the founder, actually, of the IGF Coalition on Network Neutrality, you know, working with the Vargas Foundation in Rio. Thank you for joining us. And last but not least, Gonzalo López, you accept to step in very last minute on behalf of Christoph Steck. Although we regret Christoph is not among us, I'm very happy to have you because you have been instrumental in the drafting of the paper that we all talk about those last days on network neutrality, and you are from Telefonica. Thanks a lot for joining us. I will start. I need to say that I will be helped today by a remote moderator. She stands far away over there. Thanks to Liana Galsian from ISOC Armenia. You also are a specialist in network neutrality in your country at European level. Thanks for making bridge between remote participants and this panel. And last but not least, I have my colleague Dan York, who will actually have the difficult role of making bullets at the end of this session. Thanks a lot, Dan. I'd like to start with a very general question and turn to you, Eva. And by the way, for complete transparency, I understand that you have limited time right now. We start late and you have to dash out in 1 hour. So let's take benefit of your presence right now. I have a global question. I understand that within the DSM, the Digital Strategic, Strategic Plan from the European Union, network neutrality might be an important issue. So my question is, how important is it for having the European Union as a leader in the digital economy? I mean, and the contrary might be true. If we fail to have a compromise in the European Union, would it be detrimental for the whole plan, the strategic plan of the European Union? Please.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. First of all, thank you so much for having me. Very happy to be here. When you were presenting the panel, you said we have a number of experts here. Well, I definitely do not qualify as an expert on the topic, but I'm someone that I'm very passionate about developing the digital single market across Europe as much as we can in the forthcoming years. And yes, I do believe Europe can be a much more of a leader in this type of a sphere. So I will just give you a couple of remarks that I've thought about that I would like to present to you, but I would be curious to hear the other speakers that are much more in-depth into the topic and share different perspectives. And we as policymakers tend to listen to all, at least I do. We all know that the people that created the internet, they were people with a vision. And without it, you would never create such an innovative new space for individual to openly share innovation and knowledge. And the vision of these creators was to ensure everyone, regardless of their location, to be able to have an effective platform for sharing. From today's perspective, although accessing internet everywhere, we take it something as for granted. But some years ago, some of us, and I remember the times when I was having difficulties, getting on the internet, and once I would be online, I felt like, wow, there's so many opportunities, and it's such a wonderful place. And I got reminded that it's something to some people looked like at some point in like falling into a rabbit hole like Alice in Wonderland once fell, and she found herself in Wonderland. But, she entered through a rabbit hole. We enter on the internet through all sorts of devices we can find, all different type of internet gadgets. The success of the internet, to a large extent, is based on its openness and ability to really set a low burden in order to access it. So people have endless possibilities to improve competition and innovation in this way. And these are my two key words today. This is why we need this space to remain open in order to provide and to ensure that we have a fair and balanced access between users and service providers, which ensures equal treatment and no discrimination. And this is why I think open internet has to be the ultimate goal of every policymaker. And this is why the people that draft those laws, they need to understand one thing, including me. We need to understand what digital by default means, that digitalization is and internet is our fifth freedom nowadays. And sometimes I have difficulties, and you've been in the parliament as well, and you know, sometimes you have difficulties explaining this to some of your colleagues. And when you're at the point where you need to negotiate and talk, you find yourself into a dreadlock, like we do currently with the Connected Continent discussions in the Council for quite some time now. My last point that I want to make is that we need more innovation in Europe in order if we want to be this competitive continent, if we want to be a leader, we need to invest in innovation. The market is constantly expanding, and in order to meet the needs of the existing demands, we have to support absolutely development of specialized services between users and providers. Consumers must have a choice, and me as a member of the Internal Market and Consumer Protection Committee, this is the number one thing I hear from numerous people and organizations across the continent. They have to have the freedom to easily access content and share information. So going back to Alice in Wonderland, her journey ends 5 miles away from where it started. Today, in the wonderful space that the internet offers, you can start it and end it wherever you want, or not even ever end it. And if we want to continue to have an open internet, it is of absolute importance to protect both the providers and the consumers, and this is what I'm trying to work on in the parliament. And only a clear principle of net neutrality would help us in order for us to achieve that goal.
Thank you very much. So, thank you for this. We have a political view, and we understand it's fairly difficult. Actually, when you explain it, seems crystal clear. So, where is the problem, Freud? It should be easy, actually, to make sure that people understand that having choice, transparency, and different options open in order to achieve an open internet, that should be just two statements. So where is the issue?
For me, it seems like the net neutrality debate in Europe today is stalled by some confusion about the concept. How can we understand the discussion? What is the internet? What are the services provided outside the internet, etc.? So I'm looking forward to a deeper discussion today. As far as I understand, this panel is supposed to dig a little bit into these issues. But as a starting point for the discussion, why do we want to strive for net neutrality? The main objective of this is to preserve the internet as an open platform. That's obvious. But if you look a little bit more into the details, what are the success factors of the internet? To me, it seems like the internet allows for innovation without permission. It's a statement said many times before, and it thereby provides low entry barriers for new stakeholders. In addition to that, internet users have been able to control their own access to the internet. That's important, and it's a new dimension of the freedom of expression for us. Furthermore, internet applications, they are decoupled from the internet, so you're able to use the internet for different purposes. And finally, internet communication provides global connectivity, so you can communicate over the whole world using the internet. Note that I used the phrase user control instead of user choice, because it seems like today the phrase user choice is misleading people in this discussion. It's not about choosing an access that is open, it's a question about having an access that is open. So you can use it for whatever purpose you want. Thereby, your access is in your control. You can use it without any predetermined purposes provided by the provider. However, of course, there are some exceptions, so-called reasonable exceptions. Taking a typical example would be blocking of child pornography, for example. So it doesn't mean that it's open for whatever purpose, of course, as we have with all types of freedoms, they are in you have to weigh one purpose against another one, one freedom against another one. So before we go deeper into discussion, I think I leave it by stating that it's important that end users have control of their own access. That's the purpose of the internet.
Okay, let's start with that. Users in full control of their access. So which are the conditions for this? Is it something we already have now? Should we protect this? How would it work? Luca.
Thank you, Fred. So I think that if we have to analyze the topic of today, so how the open internet can coexist with specialized services, it has to be very clear what is the open internet and what are specialized services. So the internet was, we all know, it's a connection of a multiple network, is a network of networks, and it has been conceived with a layered structure and with an end-to-end architecture. So what does it mean basically? It means that to the different layers of the internet correspond different functions, and it means that the transport of the data packet is dealt by network operators, whereas the aggregation, the treatment of the information is dealt at the application level. That means that is why it is called an end-to-end structure, because the intelligence of the network is at the application level that are run by users. So what is the side effect of this end-to-end layered structure? The side effect is that the internet is a general purpose network. It means that it is not up to the network operator to regulate how the internet will be used. The network operator simply conveys the traffic, and this is why they are considered mere conduits, because they simply convey the traffic. And it is at the application level that the information are organized. And it is the application level where the user is that has the intelligence of the network. So this other side effect of the internet, of an open internet, is that it dramatically empowers users. Is that thanks to an open internet where traffic is managed in a non-discriminatory way, and that was the default of the internet over the first 20 years. In that open structure, the internet user has for the first time the freedom, the real freedom to seek, impart, and receive information without restrictions and without regardless of frontier. So this structure is what really empowers the user. This is essential for freedom of expression for the user. So what is the problem here? The problem is that over the past 10 years, network operators have acquired the technical capability to handle traffic in a discriminatory fashion, for instance, blocking, filtering, or even prioritizing or slowing down specific applications. This is not a problem per se. The problem is that at the same time, network operators vertically integrate with content application providers. So besides having the capability to discriminate, they also have an economic incentive to do so. So this could be a simple hypothesis, but since 2012, BEREC has shown with the report that in Europe, 22% of the fixed connection are interested by these discriminatory practices, and up to 50% of the mobile connection are interested by these specific discriminatory practices. So that means that breaches of net neutrality, discriminatory traffic management, is the norm for half of mobile users and one-fifth of internet users in Europe. That is what happens in this moment. That is why we need policies and regulation on net neutrality, to protect the original end-to-end open structure and not allow intermediaries to decide how we use the internet. And by the way, I'm concluding with this, if one reads the jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights, that is exactly what the European Court of Human Rights says since the 90s. The European Court of Human Rights, since the Autronic case in 1990, is repeating that interference on the means of distribution of information, determine a restriction of internet free, individuals' freedom to impart and receive information. So the fact that an operator has the possibility to restrict and to manage traffic in a discriminatory way has an impact on the freedom of expression. And it is what has been repeated by the European Court of Human Rights since over the past 25 years, especially 2 years ago with the landmark case, the Ilderim case, where besides repeating this principle, the court has also said that restriction to freedom of expression have to be foreseen in a specific, clear and predictable legal framework. So what the court actually says, and what the court actually says applies at the Council of Europe level, so at the Council of Europe member state level, so the 47 members of the Council of Europe, is that the restrictions on the means of distribution, so also electronic network, have an impact on freedom of expression. And those restrictions have to be regulated by law.
Thank you, Luca. So it's a fairly good statement. I'd like to come back on what we try to achieve here, and this is often a conversation on how is or are IP services a threat for what you describe. So we got the open internet. To my knowledge, it functioned quite well. I was able to receive a lot of services, including Skype or Netflix on my open global internet. So now I see a new race, a new sort of services, IP services, but I understand that it might be a threat. So we just developed and described the open internet. Is someone want to take a ride on what are IP specialized services? Who? Because I want to make sure that we're talking about the same technical concepts. Who want to try it?
Can I just conclude my thought saying that...
I thought you did, but okay, do it again.
Unless someone else wants to start with what are specialized services. The thing, what I'm saying is the internet, an open internet has to be preserved like that, but that is not incompatible with specialized services. As long as those specialized services that require some enhanced functionalities, for instance, high definition, high quality, or high security, they are kept separated from the open internet. If those two things are kept logically or physically separated, they are perfectly compatible. ISPs can experiment new business model. The open internet is protected. So as long as those two things are kept separated, everyone is happy. But maybe now someone else wants to comment.
No, I'm happy that you're saying this. So it seems quite simple. So actually, we just solved the whole issue. But let's continue. Frode.
I understand specialized services as a kind of a regulatory concept. It was, for example, defined by BEREC, the umbrella organization of the European regulators, as a service where the communication is separated from the internet on the network layer, which means that the traffic is separated from the internet. And the reason for developing this concept is that there is a clear demand for quality of service-based services, says the ISPs. And in order to acknowledge that, we developed this concept. And at the same time, if we have a view of preserving net neutrality, it's important that specialized services are separated from the internet. If we don't separate them, they are actually a kind of a prioritization over the internet, which is exactly what we wanted to avoid with net neutrality. So if we accept that the goal is to achieve net neutrality, then we need to separate specialized services from the internet. And of course, they also can't degrade the capacity of the internet.
Thank you. Thank you for this clarification. Does someone want to take it from here, Amelia?
Very good. Thank you very much. So I would like to come back to a thing that Luca Belli mentioned at the beginning of his presentation, which is the internet was created to be a network of networks. When we're talking about net neutrality, very frequently we talk about protecting consumer rights inside of one network. We're effectively not talking about protecting net neutrality on the internet. We're talking about protecting consumer rights on an intranet that belongs to a single ISP. And so I think where this discussion would benefit a lot is from having this distinction clearly made. When are we talking about protecting consumer rights in an intranet that belongs to one operator? And when are we talking about protecting consumer rights or even innovator and entrepreneurial rights on the internet, where networks can be all interconnected and where there's choice, not only in terms of what services you receive, but also in terms of what services you provide. The technical development that's been happening for the last 10 years, and very quickly in the last two or three, is actually going towards software-defined networks, which I think is the elephant in the room that we're not talking about a lot. When an internet service provider is looking to make it appear as if their network is a network of networks inside of their single network by using software to create different compartments of that network. It sounds a bit technical, but it means you have one thing and you make it come across as if it's actually several things. Where both legislators and the debate at large needs to be take a lot more care is to always remember that one network is one network. If you're having a telco intranet, it's exactly that. And if we want to talk about protecting the internet in any meaningful way, we need to start thinking about this network of networks, the plural second network term in that sentence. And so this is what I would like to bring for the beginning of the discussion, and I'm looking very much forward to hearing other inputs from the panelists or from the audience on the network of networks and intranet ideas.
Thank you, Amelia. I mean, that is really spot on. So we're talking about two different things. We got IP services and the internet. Those are two different things. Now, how comes that many people believe that there is a threat with those IP services on the global internet? So how comes that we can see this? Because I quite like your differentiations. They are indeed two different things, and I hope this is clear for the audience. So, Gonzalo, how do you think we should best protect network neutrality? What's your take, and how do you see those both going forward? I heard the word separation, so how would it work from your perspective?
Well, I think that mainly the network neutrality is a competition problem. We had already, for example, been served in the IGF at Istanbul, stating that network neutrality was being born in the US as a problem where basically users, clients were not able to have different options for the ISP, and they would be just able to contract their services through only one provider. So that meant basically that this provider had the possibility to influence and to have some restrictions on the service because the customer would have no choice. And in fact, I think that this framework is completely different in Europe. We think we have much many more providers, and users have the freedom to switch from providers from one to another. So I think that the competition issue, it's completely different here than the one that we have in the US. In fact, Vince was already talking about solutions to protect network neutrality, such as the unbundling of the loop, such as wholesale service providers, all which have been already present in Europe for many years now. So I think that customers, for example, have many options, like three, four different broadband providers to have access to the internet. So I think that the best way to protect network neutrality would be basically guaranteeing that this competitiveness of the market is in place and that the customers have the information to make informed choices, and they have the information enough to be able to choose the different providers, and that there's a switching mechanism from one provider to other so that they can choose, and they have a good chance to choose the best service that best covers their needs. And in fact, with this competition environment, us providers will be willing to offer the best service possible to our customers. So it's against our incentives to block, to neither throttle the services that our customers are willing to get, because otherwise they'd be switching to other providers. And in this respect, I would like to say that at Telefonica, we do not throttle, we do not block any kind of service to our customers. And also, I would like to mention regarding human rights that we at Telefonica, and I would probably add it to most of the ISPs, we do not have any intention to restrict human rights. It is not something that we are willing, we are not doing at any point.
Thank you. I see many hands raised within the panel. I forgot to mention we have a 6th panelist that would be the audience remotely and yourself. I really, and we all would like all of you to contribute and participate to this panel in a very interactive way. So do we have any request or comment from the audience, please? Do we have a mic? I can, if you mind.
I will.
Please introduce your name and speak.
Louise Bennett, BCS Information Society. You just mentioned that in the US there is less competition between providers. What's the view of the panel on the fact that the European Competition Commissioners are now allowing much more consolidation of telco companies and providers in Europe, which will reduce the competition we currently have in Europe enormously?
Thank you very much, Agathe. Can I ask one or two other comments from the audience, and then I will try to give the part back to you. Okay. Please.
We have a remote. We have questions from the remote participants. I would like to read the question from Zdravko Jukic. A question for the panelists, if possible. Imagine a market with 6 players, 5 are offering internet access service and some specialized services, while one player is offering just some specialized services, but not the IIS. Would that be a problem of network neutrality?
Thank you. Thank you for the question.
And also another question, just I'm reading on a Twitter, there is a discussion about the one internet, one is open and one is a bit closed. So please regard as questions and while discussing in the panel.
Thank you. I have seen this tweet as well, and I would like to thank the one who tweeted this, because there might be a problem in Europe and elsewhere, is that there is a temptation to label this intranet, like you describe it, Amelia, as being the global internet. So we might need to fix this here. I would like to take yet another question. Elvana?
Thank you very much. Elvana Thaci from the Council of Europe. I have a couple of comments. First, I find the title of this session quite misleading, and it has been changing, I think, throughout the updates of the program.
No, it didn't, but please comment.
It was net neutrality before, I think, at some point. But anyway, the other point I'd like to share here is that I don't see in the panel any of the intergovernmental organizations where regulation, legislation on network neutrality is being negotiated. In the European Union, we have a trilogue going on now on regulation on network neutrality. In the Council of Europe, there is an intergovernmental negotiation going on network neutrality policy. So this is, governments are really a key stakeholder, and intergovernmental organizations are a key stakeholder here. And if you wish all the views to be taken into consideration, the views that have been just expressed, I think it's useful to have governments and intergovernmental organizations on board. Now, I'd like to share with you the Council of Europe's perspectives on the network neutrality policy and the principle. Yes, indeed, we need the network neutrality principle because this is a derivative of the right to freedom of expression and access to information. And it was explained, I think, in the panel that traffic management can be an interference with freedom of expression. And if it's an interference, then it has to comply with the requirements of the European Convention on Human Rights on the legality, necessity in a democratic society, and proportionality. Now, how do you translate these requirements to this very technical and very, very complex, legally speaking, complex situation? In the Council of Europe, we have taken so far in a draft policy, and I stress it's a draft policy, it's not finalized yet. The approach we have taken is to consider the principle of network neutrality as underpinning the right to freedom of expression. As the right to freedom of expression, the principle is not absolute. It has exemptions. One of the exemptions is traffic management for purposes of to address network congestion. Prioritization of services, which I think in this title of this panel is the IP services, as far as I understand, are also not prohibited. These can be an exemption, but there should be safeguards in laws and policies about protecting the right to freedom of expression, about notifying the users, about the quality of service that they are getting so that they receive what they're paying for. And they have information about any type of filtering or blocking of information that might be taking place in this context. So I'd like to stress this, safeguards for freedom of expression in whichever law or policy or regulation on network neutrality we will have in place. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Please.
I would like to make a statement as well as ask a question. In regards to what has been addressed already on the ongoing discussions on net neutrality in the TSM file, when it comes to network congestions, we talk about traffic management on the network, not on the content of the network, and service providers, specialized services are about content as far as I get it. My question is towards all of the panelists. What do you think are the dangers when it comes to saving the net neutrality? That's it.
So,
what do you think are the dangers?
Net neutrality. Hold on right now. There are many more questions, and I thank you a lot for this. But if you agree, I would like to push back to the panel now. So we have three main avenues here, right? I expected the question, thank you a lot. I would like to park it a little bit right now. This is a US-EU comparison. We will certainly address this, but I would not like to hijack the conversation now. So we had a question about competition in general, and by the way, is it sufficient to ensure network neutrality? I guess there are lots to say. We had a comment on traffic management from the Council of Europe and with the different aspects that we can take in terms of exemptions. I would like to hear from you on that one and more generally on network neutrality and the danger. And then I'd like to myself add something, Elvana, you nicely commented. We all eagerly would like to hear from you where you are with the Council of Europe about your recommendation, network neutrality. I mean, what's the status of it? But that's for later in the panel. Who want to take the three angles? We start with you, Luca.
Okay, I would like to start with the competition question, stating that competition is essential for net neutrality, but it is not sufficient. So it is an essential condition, but competition itself, as well as transparency itself, does not solve the problem. In Europe, it is we have a highly competitive market, and with a transparency obligation since 2009 with the telecom package. But as the BEREC report in 2012 has proved, there are still some players that use discriminatory traffic management, despite of competition. This for two simple reasons. First, if every player in the market throttles and has anti-competitive measures, you don't have a choice. Everyone is throttling you. So competition is useless in that case. Secondly, users do not realize that they have been throttled or blocked, because I would like to make a quick survey. Even if the ISP says explicitly in his contractual agreement that he's throttling you, how many people in this room, there are I think 200 people, how many people have read the conditions of their internet access service provider? Of those three, four people, five, how many work for an internet service provider, or how many of you have no connection with internet service provider? Two, three, okay. So we are 200 people and there are three or maybe four persons that have read
that conditions for personal interest. So that makes it a very tiny fraction of the internet users with the unforeseen survey that read and know that they have been throttled or not. So transparency, it is not efficient simply because if you have 200 pages of condition saying how have you been throttled and blocked, you will not read them and you will not understand them. And competition is essential but not efficient, because if everyone in the market is throttling you, you will not have a choice. And besides that, as I was saying at the very beginning, the internet is a network of networks. So if you have some network that block, it also reflects on the other network's possibility to access the information that are in that network. So if we do not consider the internet as broadcasting, but as a network of network, competition itself is not sufficient. Can I also provide a quick comment on the intention to keep prioritization as an exception? I perfectly agree there are exceptions to network neutrality. As freedom of expression, network neutrality is not absolute. You have expression, for instance, when you have a court order that tells you that something has to be blocked because it is illegal. For instance, for temporary and exceptional congestion measures. But hearing that prioritization is an exception, it is something that I do not really consider as compatible with net neutrality. And it was obvious in the recently issued FCC order that prioritization would ban, and it is obvious that prioritization has an impact on freedom of expression. So I'm very happy to know that the policy of the Council of Europe is still a draft, and I hope that will be corrected.
Thank you. I'd like to have Amelia.
Very good. So. First, on the competition and consolidation strategy of the European Commission, that's bad, right? Even the competition authority of the European communities knows that it's bad. They've received heavy criticism from competition policy think tanks. They know themselves that they're making the bad choices, and they're still making it because somewhere someone has convinced top-level politicians that you need consolidation in order to have investments. Now, Lucabelli mentions that the European Union is a place where we have a highly competitive telecoms market. That is only partially true. The highest level of investments we see in the truly competitive markets of the European Union, which is mostly Scandinavia. Like in Sweden, you can go out on the countryside and you still have 100 megabit symmetric fiber connection. Whereas in Belgium, when I came there in 2010, and I was a naive and young Swedish 22-year-old believing that I had landed in Western Europe, civilization, and we had a 4 gigabyte traffic limit per month, I could not watch YouTube videos, you know, every day and still be within my quota, which was incomprehensible to me at the time, but which is still the case for some Belgian households, you know. There are no fiber to the home connections in all of Belgium. In Germany, less than 1% of all the households have fiber to the home connections. This clearly is not because they have too much competition, it's because they have too little competition. And so I disagree that we've succeeded on the competition part in the European Union, and I think the net neutrality discussions that we're having are largely actually caused by the fact that the vast majority of European citizens do not have as many choices as they need, the investments are far too low, and it's because politicians down-prioritize competition for whatever reason. Now, as regards with the freedom of speech and human rights protections, like traffic management has privacy implications, it has freedom of speech implications, but my feeling from the European Parliament, which I know Eva is more updated than me on this, but when I was there last year, we ended up talking about these dreary kind of business model selections for ISPs, like imagine you're an ISP and you have a network, then what kind of business model would you like to inflict on your consumers? And the legislator is not the most appropriate actor to be discussing specific business models. They could choose something like in the e-privacy directive of the European Union, the ISP should not in general monitor communications. That would be perfectly sufficient to not have any unreasonable traffic management. People like the Norwegian Telecommunications Authority would afterwards go in and scrutinize the telcos and ensure that no undue traffic management is done. And the legislation, the way the policy debate as it's framed in Europe is too far from these general principles of what the legislators actually want, and too much into the grimy details of whether or not you can imagine an extra surcharge to be imposed on an end consumer in an intranet in a specific circumstance where some criteria are fulfilled. This we should leave to the business executives of Telefonica, because first of all, the discussions are boring, and the European Parliament is not the right institutions to have them in either case. Now, the danger of network neutrality discussions in the European Union is exactly that legislators and even ministers have been dragged into these business model discussions rather than the principled discussions of how do we deal with privacy, which is a big issue, how do we deal with freedom of speech in networks, which is also a big issue, and then, of course, the competition policy issues, which are also not being discussed. So it's like you have these three major principal issues that are so suitable for political discussions, and instead we're discussing everything but those three big topics that would be most adequate and relevant for both legislators and, I think, this part of the panel and, you know, for us to be discussing. So that would be my comments on that.
Thank you, Amelia. Actually, it's a good transition, if you allow me, to Eva. So this is a clear message from a previous MEP to a new MEP. So why don't you just stick to very strict principles that we can all agree on?
You know, there are some people that are interested in discussing the three points Emilia mentioned. The point is...